Today, we are marking the start of a new series, The Complete All Technique and Ability Guide. And where to start other than our main protagonist, Son Goku, host to a wide range of different abilities at his disposal. As Dragon Ball evolved, so has Goku's power, as he's able to break through limit after limit, upgrading, enhancing, and learning new moves that helped him overcome characters with hacks and just unfair abilities. Although, I must say, as a disclaimer, in this video I'll not be covering all of Goku's transformations and power-ups in great detail, as I already made a video of Goku all forms and transformations. That is one of the best videos out there. It already has 10 million views, so if you're interested in power levels and forms, then I urge you to watch that video. However, in this video, we'll break down Goku's skill sets into 5 different categories. First, we're going to talk about his physical abilities. We're going to analyze and mention some strength feats and physical attributes. Secondly, we're going to mention his mental abilities, which are some of his most underrated and overlooked skills. Then we're moving on to movesets, no pun intended. Those will involve some of Goku's prominent signature moves and key manipulation techniques, used for both offensive and defensive purposes. Afterwards, and although not much, we're going to talk about some equipments that Goku used. I may also talk about transformations, however, I'll only mention the multiplication for each of the 6 prominent Super Saiyan transformations that Goku underwent in the Dragon Ball anime. If you want a more detailed history of his age and when he unlocked each form, then I suggest you watch the All Forms and Transformations video, as I suggested before. This might be a lengthy video, however, I promise that you will enjoy some of the knowledge and research I did. So sit back, grab a snack, and let's get right to it. Goku. Son Goku. As a Saiyan, Goku naturally possesses superhuman strength even without training. Thanks to his Saiyan physiology, he survived a fall to the head which would naturally be lethal to any adult, let alone a small child. In fact, the weakest version of Goku that we ever saw in the very first episode of the entire franchise was a Goku with a power level of 12. He was able to lift a car and throw it. In addition, he could easily tank bullets from a gun and barely get scathed. Goku's natural physical strength, even as a child, makes him immune to almost all earthly weapons, as he was easily able to take down an entire military army with advanced weapons and robots, demonstrating abilities of dodging, catching, and deflecting bullets. Even more impressively, he was shown to dodge laser beams, which are said to be as fast as light. Then again, that's moving to his speed feats. But whenever the topic of strength is brought to the table, Goku's strength is immediately dismissed for his lifting feats, or rather, the lack thereof, as the low-end feat would suggest that he's only able to lift up to 40 tons as a Super Saiyan during the Buu arc, equating to 400 tons when applying the gravity change. However, the lifting feats are meaningless and unrepresenting to his actual strength, as all of these lifting showings are contradicted and overshadowed by Goku's striking prowess, as even without the use of ki, Goku is shown to block and push back an island thrown at him by Frieza. In addition, although filler, Piccolo was also shown to lift an entire pyramid with the use of his mind. And mind you, no pun intended, each block of a pyramid weighs about 2.5 tons. So if you equate this to a real-life representation of a pyramid which consists of an estimate of 2.3 million blocks, then that would essentially mean Piccolo in the Saiyan Saga was able to lift up to 5.7 million tons worth of pyramid. Now, as I said, this might be less believable as it's a filler scene, but on the flip side, Piccolo lifting pyramids via telekinesis is not as impressive when you consider that Goku, in non-filler scenes, was able to shoot a Kamehameha from his own hands and then was able to push back and nullify that attack. This Kamehameha attack could easily have enough force to destroy entire planets. So while Goku doesn't show off how much he can bench press, he has shown time and time again that he can hurt characters who can survive planet explosions, such as Frieza. In addition to that, he was able to redirect a planet-busting move by his own fist, adding force to it that it can travel in light speeds in space. And that's only early Dragon Ball Z. And this is not even mentioning Goku's God Mode in early Dragon Ball Super, which has shown the capacity to destroy the entire universe when he clashed against the God of Destruction. So to wrap up the strength feats, it is best to recognize that anime doesn't necessarily follow real-life physics, as manga authors don't require a science degree to write fiction. Plus, lifting showings are irrelevant in a fight, as it's likely that while Goku can physically lift up to 400 tons in the Buu arc, he can still, with his ki, generate and nullify forces that have enough mass power to destroy entire cosmos. So next time you try to scale Goku, just consider who would win in a fight, the strongest powerlifter or the best fighter. Or a better analogy would be, who's stronger, you who can lift 20 pounds or someone with the strength to easily crush 20 pounds due to his ability that transcends normal physics? By the same token, since Goku can generate this much destructive power, his body is also incredibly durable to those same attacks. Provided he doesn't let his guard down, Goku's pretty much immune to all weapons as we mentioned before. He's also immune to multi-galactic busting move at his base form no less. In fact, when Goku fought Frieza and Namek, Frieza tried to destroy the planet in order to defeat Goku, but not because the explosion would kill him, but rather the lack of oxygen as a result, as Goku cannot breathe in space. However, he's still able to survive and fight for long periods in Earth's stratosphere due to his immense lung capacity, which also means he can stay inside water for long periods of time. Goku's body is also resilient against high temperatures. This was first seen when he was able to calmly relax in the boiling hot saunas of Princess Snake's palace. Though, as the years went by, his resistance to heat only increased, as he was able to fall through the Earth's atmosphere without burning up from the high-speed descent. Perhaps one of the most impressive displays of his heat resistance is in Dragon Ball Super Broly, when he's fighting against Broly in lava and both characters are unaffected by the boiling magma. However, this could be due to Goku's energy acting as a barrier against the lava and not because his body is naturally resistant to such high temperatures. However, it's interesting to mention that in Dragon Ball GT, Goku's body is also immune to lava, as he mentions that he would not even feel the 6,000 degrees heat. Moreover, Goku's Super Saiyan 4 wasn't affected at all by the high voltage attacks of Raid Shenron, as he claims all it does is warm his body a little bit. Goku's Saiyan body also remembers and adapts quickly to attacks. When Ice Shenron freezes Goku, his body immediately resists and is unaffected by the freeze move as his body experienced it before. Therefore, Goku's unaffected by either extremely low or high temperatures. And even if he would, his body would adapt the second time.
It's supposed to be an impenetrable beam.
You can't use the same move on me twice. My body remembers and compensates the next round.
That's ridiculous!
Which brings us to one of his broken genetic traits, the Zenkai Boost. Although a fan term, the ability itself is very authentic. Even though it's often used as a plot device, Zenkais are an exclusive Saiyan ability that permits the user an immense permanent power boost whenever the Saiyan experiences a near-death experience. More often than not, increases their battle power to the point where they can combat previous threats. This was first demonstrated by Vegeta when he experienced his first Zenkai boost in the series, increasing his power level from 18k to 24,000, roughly the same power level as Goku's Kaioken times 3. The second time Vegeta experienced a Zenkai boost was in Namek after he was defeated by Zarbon. Upon healing, Vegeta easily one-shotted Zarbon despite being overwhelmed in their previous fight. A real implication of how Zenkais would work in real life is, say you get hit by a car and manage to survive. Most humans that heal would likely be weaker and be more susceptible to injury or relapses. However, a Saiyan that hypothetically experiences a car crash and heals would literally not only survive it next time, but would be unscathed and have the car be destroyed instead.
Not this strong when you fought Raccoon!
Looks like you have some required reading to do.
Alright, let's see here. Kai, full moon, lose your tiles, stronger every time you... Oh. Well, I'm right f***ed, aren't I?
Right in the down under.
Now lastly, but certainly not least, is Goku's incredible speed, often downplayed and underestimated by many people who never watched Dragon Ball. If you judge Goku by how fast he moves according to the animation on screen, then you will never figure out how fast he is. As I pointed out before, Goku is able to dodge laser beams and fight in speeds that are untraceable to the naked eye. Master Roshi and Krillin actually had an entire fight under a second, where a sequence of events occurred without anyone being able to witness due to how massively fast they were moving. Which isn't a surprise since Kid Goku was able to outrun light when he managed to move fast enough not only to dodge the solar flare attack, but to also grab Master Roshi's sunglasses and wear it to block the attack from hurting his eyes. Goku also dodges attacks from point-blank range that are fast enough to travel in light speeds, as evident with Piccolo destroying the moon in seconds, and Vegeta's final flash blowing up a random faraway planet. Furthermore, Goku upon first arriving in Namek was incredibly fast that attacks were going through him as he appears to be standing still. Though after further inspection, Vegeta narrates that Goku was able to dodge them despite appearing that he was standing still.
Goku! No! Unbelievable! How could he be that fast? It looks as if he never moved. But that can't be. He's so fast that his movements can't be detected even by seeing eyes.
Goku travel speed is also impressive, as it was canonically mentioned that he was able to travel from the other side of planet Namek in less than a second when he confronted Frieza for the very first time. In fact, King Kai, who can trace and track spaceships that travel in light speeds, wasn't able to keep up with how fast Sajie Goku and Frieza were fighting on Namek, claiming he never had this issue before. In fact, if you're skeptical about all of this and consider all these outliers, then even taking the lowest end feat you can possibly think of, which would be Goku's speed being as fast as machine guns, then applying a bit of math and using the SSJ multipliers, Goku would reach FTL speeds in the later parts of the show. In Dragon Ball Super, additionally, Dispo was mentioned to have reached speeds faster than light, which doesn't even make sense. But like we said, you don't watch Dragon Ball to learn physics. But you also can't deny that Goku without a doubt is FTL. The only debate here is in which part of the series he was.
He dodged it! He's faster than the speed of light!
So to conclude this section of the video, Goku is immensely powerful and debated to be above the third dimension, having what seems like infinite power. Now that doesn't mean he's omnipotent, but he's certainly stronger than what many think. The aim here wasn't to find the exact numbers of tons he can lift, nor find the exact numbers of universes he can bust. There are many other YouTubers that will speculate that for you. My aim here was simply to mention some indisputable basic facts about his strength. So with that being said, let's move on to his mental capabilities.
Will you stop attacking yourself? I don't know where you got it in your head that there's something wrong with you, because there's not!
What's draining your strength is your own doubt. Just don't listen to it, okay?
A term that you most likely heard when watching, reading, or playing any Dragon Ball game is the term ki. One of the most fundamental things about Dragon Ball and their characters, the ability to manipulate one's life energy. According to Toriyama, the author, ki is made up of three components: Genki, Yuki, and Shoki. With the mastery of its composition, a character like Goku can transcend the laws of physics and demonstrate supernatural abilities, granting him many techniques that would naturally be unattainable without its mastery. And this brings us to his Goku's fighting brilliance, as he mentally shows frightening capacity to learn moves or techniques that would take characters many years to attain, as evident with Goku learning the Kamehameha on the spot by merely seeing it once. Where Master Roshi, a martial arts master, the strongest fighter on Earth at one point, took him 50 years to develop the technique. Goku's capacity of learning techniques makes him not only mimic them, but also develop them and create stronger versions and variations of them. His limitless potential, along his insatiable hunger to grow, makes him catch up to even gods such as Beerus that existed for millions of years, mastering and demonstrating attacks that mortals shouldn't be able to do, as he learned and mastered Ultra Instinct after experiencing it only once, and also performed the Hakai despite not being a god of destruction. Okay, albeit not the complete version, but the fact that he managed to do it by himself is only an indication that he could eventually master it, because he likely never practiced it, as Goku is a character that doesn't kill if not needed. Goku's ki manipulation has further granted him a level of control that he is able to sense power levels very far away. He could also determine the identity of which power that it belongs to. He could also lock onto their energy and teleport to them via instant transmission. His ability to sense ki is actually so extraordinary to the point where he can read a character's intent based on their ki reading alone. This was demonstrated when he didn't flinch when Trunks tried to attack him, claiming he read his emotions based on his ki and determined that he would stop.
Let's find out. Why didn't you try to avoid it?
I searched your feelings, so I knew that you would stop.
Goku takes this to a further degree when he shows the ability to read minds, as he places his palms on Krillin's forehead, allowing him to foresee all the previous events that occurred on Namek. Goku could also use this technique on magical creatures such as Majin Buu. This was likely due to Goku's mastery of telekinesis and telepathic ability, where he can move objects with his mind and communicate with people. Goku showed that he could keep up with fighting 100% Final Form Frieza while still able to listen to the conversation of Kame and King Kai. Likewise with Goku being able to master these components or elements of ki manipulations, this gives him resistance to magic and telekinesis from fighters that are significantly weaker than him. This is evident by the wizard Babidi, who could easily kill and teleport people at will, but his power is ineffective against someone with godlike abilities like Goku. Even the magical Shenron or his buffer Chad counterpart Purunga can't kill Goku. In fact, humorously enough, Purunga needed to ask permission from Goku when the Z Fighters tried to wish him back to Earth. Telekinesis, like we said, is also ineffective as shown by General Blue, who could use paralysis against Kid Goku, but failed to do it when meeting a stronger foe in Mercenary Tao. Therefore, Goku is naturally immune to almost all magic and psychic attacks. There are obviously some notable exceptions, but those are special cases. But as mentioned, the flare of his ki alone could cause rocks to fly upwards. In some instances, his power could cause the entire earth to shake. He could also theoretically bust through one dimension to another if he opted, as shown by Bu Han when he got insanely angry. However, Goku's ki control makes him limit the damage he causes. That's why when he attacks in the later part of the series, he can control the radius of the blast so it doesn't destroy the entire planet. This explains why Goku shooting a Kamehameha in God mode doesn't destroy Earth, or him powering up doesn't always cause earthquakes, like with SSJ3. The stronger he gets, the more efficient he can use his ki in some cases, as evident with him mastering Super Saiyan 1 and also Super Saiyan Blue, in which they were both described as forms that strain the user. Before we move to the next category, I just want to mention a few things regarding Goku's knowledge on performing some techniques. For instance, Goku has the knowledge to perform the fusion dance with any fighter similar in power. Goku obviously uses this with Vegeta in order to summon the forever badass Gogeta. Goku also has the knowledge to perform the Mafuba. With the right equipment, Goku can use an ancient sealing technique to trap demons inside. Originally, the failings of this technique could restrain the user enough, resulting in their death. However, in Dragon Ball Super, that weakness was completely no longer an issue, as the technique could seal almost anyone. So in theory, Goku could defeat any threat he faces if he uses this technique. Of course, there's always going to be some notable exceptions, but I felt the need to mention this before I go on and talk about his movesets. I want to add a little disclaimer here before I continue on with this section of the video, is that I will not be counting literally every single move Goku has used. I'll only mention the prominent signature attacks, meaning I will not mention every single variation of the Kamehameha. Otherwise, I will literally not be able to finish this video. So for efficiency's sake, I'll talk about the signature attacks. Also, do me a favor, if you're still watching this video, drop a like and subscribe if you haven't. Thank you. So anyways, despite the fact that Goku has not developed many original techniques by himself, he has instead learned many moves from either being taught or observing them by himself, incorporating these moves as part of his arsenal, giving him a great amount of versatility when it comes to his move pool, as he's able to access them for either offensive or defensive purposes. The first move that Goku was ever taught was not the Kamehameha, but the Rock, Scissors, and Paper, or rather, the Jankin, which is a technique taught to Goku by Grandpa Gohan, which employs one of three attack styles: either a closed fist assault, a two-finger japping assault, or an open palm thrust assault. It was Goku's signature attack early on during his childhood, soon afterwards being replaced with the Kamehameha. And speaking of which, Goku's Kamehameha is by far the most iconic attack in the entire Dragon Ball franchise. In fact, it could be argued to be one of the most iconic in anime. Since mastering this technique, Goku was able to continuously evolve the move as he got stronger. Since learning the technique from Master Roshi, Goku has never stopped creating different versions of the Kamehameha in battle, as he was able to execute a feat Kamehameha that would lift him off the ground in order to attack his opponent in the air. Goku was also strategically seen using a double Kamehameha in battle to divert his opponent's attention. Goku has brilliantly mixed his attack with his instant transmission, creating the iconic variation of Warp Kamehameha, which was used against Perfect Cell, incinerating the upper half of his body. What makes this attack dangerous is the amount of ki that Goku puts into this attack, resulting into an explosive outburst of blue energy in most cases that could wipe out the toughest of foes. Goku managed to take this technique to such a degree that he was able to create a Limit Breaker Kamehameha, or rather, God Kamehameha, when he fought Beerus. It's also notable to mention that Goku managed to create a red version of the Kamehameha in Dragon Ball GT as Super Saiyan 4. a variation known as Kamehameha times 10. And as the name suggests, this move is incredibly powerful, perhaps one of his strongest finishing moves. Now, I won't dwell much more on the different versions as I could easily make an entire video dedicated to each different version. But another move which knows a little variation and isn't used often enough is the Destructo Disc or the Kanzon, a move originally developed by Krillin. This move, while it lacks the accuracy, it has the ability to seemingly cut through anything. Another move learned by a comrade is the Solar Flare. Although used for mostly defensive purposes, the move is incredibly useful as it uses the sun in order to blind an enemy, giving Goku different avenues to attack. This was seen when he used the Solar Flare against Great Ape Vegeta to buy time in order to charge the Spirit Bomb. Speaking of which, the Genki Dama is considered one of Goku's strongest moves, believed to be by some fans to be the ultimate attack. While not necessarily true, the strength of its fear is directly related to how much Goku could charge it. Experienced its first limitation when Goku could only draw energy from planet Earth. However, Goku continually learned to expand the range of which he could gather energy, thereby increasing both the size and power of the Spirit Bomb, where he managed to draw energy from stars as seen in Planet Namek and eventually from the entire universe as seen in Dragon Ball GT. He has also demonstrated the ability to absorb the Spirit Bomb in his Super Saiyan form and one-shot Super 13 in Movie 7. This is not the only move Goku used to amplify his power, as prior to discovering the ability to go Super Saiyan, Goku relied on the Kaioken to amplify his power. This move was initially so physically taxing that the inventor of the move, King Kai, urged Goku to not use a times 3 Kaioken. However, knowing Goku, he not only went times 3, but also went times 20, multiplying his power by 20 folds in short periods and didn't suffer the same recoil and physical strain that he did when he used the times 3 Kaioken. In fact, thanks to Super Saiyan Blue's incredible ki control, Goku managed to use Super Saiyan Blue Kaioken times 10, which was said to probably kill him. However, he seems to later on master it and even reach Kaioken times 20. This is not the only technique Goku uses to stack on with other moves, as Goku is famously known to be able to teleport anywhere in the universe if he locks into someone's ki. The instant transmission, like all previous moves, has evolved as Goku could use this move in battle to avoid and confuse enemies who are vastly faster than him. Another move that Goku uses during a pinch is the famous Dragon Fist, where Goku transfers most of his ki into his fist and launch an incredible fist of fury that could strike down any enemy. In fact, this technique has never failed to strike down an opponent. It killed Harutagon, Super 17, and Ice Shenron. The only exception here is Omega Shenron, who was able to regenerate after the impact. But it's incredible how it almost killed him when Goku's other signature attack, the Kamehameha times 10, didn't even work, making his Super Dragon Fist one of his strongest moves. While in Dragon Ball Super, Goku has yet to demonstrate this move, he has instead his own version of a fatal move, as in the manga he has shown the ability to perform the Hakai. Although not the complete version, it was still working slowly against Merged Zamasu, almost erasing him had he not used Mai as a shield. What's very interesting about this move is that it isn't supposed to be used by a mortal, as it's an exclusive only to Gods of Destruction, which may explain why it wasn't complete. Though, another god move I'd like to mention is Goku's God Bind, a move which Goku utilizes unique hand movements, projecting his godly ki outwards and encasing an enemy within the extension of his aura. This technique seems to embody the fighting style of the Super Saiyan God, utilizing the godly ki for techniques of an equally godly class. The final move or technique I'd like to mention is Goku's Ultra Instinct, the art of automatic self-movement. Goku began learning this from Whis. During the Tournament of Power, Goku unlocked this special state, enabling him to use this power. While very crude at first and only applied defensively, he ultimately learned to complete this power to defend and attack simultaneously with optimum efficiency. With this power, he is able to instinctively and instantly react to any nearby threat in the most effective way possible. However, Goku's usage of this ability is only unlocked subconsciously during dire situations. This state of power is widely considered by many fans to be Goku's most powerful version in the show. Okay, so before we move on to the next category, I'd like to point out here the notable mentions on screen. I'd love to stay and describe each one of them, but I feel like I need to say something, otherwise the comment section down below will be littered with people screaming, "How could I miss this technique and that technique?" So here you go, guys. A Given how we just discussed the plethora amount of moves that Goku has, it stands to reason that not many would reflect on some of the items that Goku carry. Albeit he doesn't carry the bat belt around his waist, he still has a few useful tools. In fact, since Akira Toriyama's inspiration of Son Goku was based on Sun Wukong, his power pole staff is actually also based from the Chinese novel. This was inherited by Goku from Korin and became a signature tool for Goku throughout his childhood. It's extremely durable and resilient as it's blessed with a unique power to extend and retract in vast lengths at the user's will. Apart from aid in battle, the power pole also serves as the only non-flying means to reach the lookout, signifying your worthiness of meeting God. Another inheritance that used to be synonymous with Goku's childhood was the Flying Nimbus, a mystical yellow cloud originally a gift from Master Roshi. It is a blazingly fast cloud that can carry its traveler wherever the rider wishes and also be summoned from seemingly anywhere on Earth. However, the cloud will only carry those void of any negative thoughts. All others will instantly pass through like any other cloud. This was Goku's means of traveling before he mastered flying. Another type of equipment that Goku used was his weighted clothes. While it suppresses a warrior's full power while training, the mass of the weighted can be increased to gain more power. Weighted clothes generate similar results as gravity training, but are limited by how little they can increase Goku's power in comparison. However, they could still be used while in gravity chambers or the Room of Spirit and Time, granting Goku some explosive results. However, while the use of weighted clothes became sort of redundant and obsolete by other methods of training, one thing that has always been useful ever since its introduction is the Senso Beam, healing the user and nursing them back to full health. No matter how strong Goku became, it seems like the Senso has always been reliable to restore his power to what seemed like full power, making this one of his most effective items to be held. Another item that Goku possesses is the Zenu button. With the Omni King Zeno took a great liking in Goku and wanted him to be his friend, the Grand Ruler himself gave Goku a special clicker, having two buttons on it. One could be used to instantly teleport Goku to Zeno's palace, and the other would bring Zeno straight to Goku. When battling the immortal Zamasu, seeing no other way out, Goku used the button to summon future Zeno, who immediately proceeded to erase Zamasu. With this button, Goku could theoretically use Zeno to destroy any foe he chooses.
Damn it! Come on! No! It's gone! Kill too many innocent people!
Perhaps one of the most unique things about the character Goku is his ability to increase his power, as not many fictional characters has this much capacity as Goku to transform, as some characters need special conditions to do so. However, with Goku, each Super Saiyan form signifies and embodies a fragment of the series. For example, when you say Super Saiyan 3, you would immediately think about the Buu arc. Goku's ability to break his limits serves as a testament to his character, but like I said in the beginning of this video, I won't go into much detail about every form, we'll just mention some multipliers and basic details. So to start this off, the first Super Saiyan transformation occurred on Namek, spurring Goku, who was on the verge of defeat from Frieza, going Super Saiyan, giving him a 50 times multiplier to his base form, taking his power level from 3 million to 150. This was actually confirmed to be a legitimate power level by Akira Toriyama, the last recorded one in fact. A lot of people are actually skeptical about the 50 times multiplier, however, it makes a lot of sense. Since Goku's Kaioken times 20 wasn't enough to beat Frieza, as Frieza's 50% power level was 60 million. So the 50 times multiplier pushed him into being stronger than 100% final form Frieza, whose power level was recorded to be 120 million. However, with Super Saiyan 2 and Super Saiyan 3, there wasn't much said about power levels, but rather they were mentioned as multipliers of strength. This further indicates that in the later parts of the series, it's very difficult to know how much these power-ups multiply by exactly. Therefore, even saying Super Saiyan 2 being a multiplier of 100 times isn't exactly accurate. However, it is commonly accepted to be as such in the Dragon Ball community. Now moving on to Goku's God forms in Dragon Ball Super, we have no official number, and while a lot of people like to speculate on hypothetical multipliers, the closest thing we got is Akira Toriyama saying if Beerus was a 10 out of 10 in terms of power, then Whis would be a 15 and Goku would be a 6 out of 10. However, this only applies to Battle of Gods movie, as Akira Toriyama himself admitted in the same interview that he had no idea where the show was going. Therefore, I don't believe these numbers would be applicable either on the manga or the anime of Dragon Ball Super, as even Goku's Super Saiyan Blue Kaioken didn't surpass Beerus despite people speculating that Super Saiyan Blue is 50 times the strength of Super Saiyan God, as Super Saiyan Blue was basically described as going Super Saiyan while in Super Saiyan God. I personally don't necessarily believe the multiplier, as nothing was official, but it is up to interpretation. One thing no one can deny though is that the form is incredibly strong. Since I like to do things in chronological order, Super Saiyan 4 is Goku's ultimate Super Saiyan transformation in the GT timeline. This form is said by many fans to be a 10 times multiplier of strength from Super Saiyan 3, making it a 4,000 times multiplier from Goku's base strength. The 10 times was actually speculated based on the fact that the Uzora form was confirmed to be a 10 times multiplier. In fact, this multiplier is inaccurate despite being commonly accepted in the community, as the GT Perfect Files explicitly states the following: Super Saiyan 4. The form which draws out the battle power which Saiyans possesses out to the utmost limit is this, Super Saiyan 4. It's distinguished by having a different appearance than previous Super Saiyans, with red body fur and long black hair. It is called Super Saiyan 4 out of convenience. But due to it being a transformation from Golden Uzaro, it will be no exaggeration to call it a different species from all the previous Super Saiyans. Therefore, Super Saiyan 4 is actually a limit breaker, drawing the user's full potential. This actually makes more sense to why Goku regains his adult form as a Super Saiyan 4, and how Vegeta looks younger, as Super Saiyan 4 is theorized as a transformation that reverts the user back to their physical prime. As even Goku seems to have a more fair skin tone compared to his tanner skin tone in the beginning of Dragon Ball GT. Vegeta's hair also reverts back to how it was in DBZ after he went Super Saiyan 4, as Vegeta was designed by Akira Toriyama differently in Dragon Ball GT. Intrigued by this information, I dug deeper in the GT Perfect Files in order to find some more answers that could uncover more truth to the Super Saiyan 4 multiplier. There I found some interesting notes regarding Uzara Baby Vegeta, which stated that Super Baby transformed into this form after being bathed with 1,000 times the normal amount of Blutz waves. If we take this information at face value, then that would mean that 1,000 times stronger Blutz wave would suggest that Super Saiyan 4 is around a 10,000 times multiplier. Again, these aren't confirmed, but they are more legitimate than the 10 times multiplier thrown around, which actually has no source to it, surprisingly, despite everybody using it as a fact. Anyways, I tried to be as objective as possible without spreading false information or too many headcanons. If you'd like to speculate yourself on some of these numbers, then please use the comments section down below to facilitate that. You give me so high. You give me so high. Wow, like I cannot actually begin to explain to you guys how amazing it feels to reach this point of the video. It actually took me around 2 weeks to finish this one, because as you can see, this is not your average Dragon Ball video. I did my best to make sure I was very thorough with my research. So if you managed to sit through this insanely long video and reach this point without getting sick of my voice, then you have my eternal thanks. And you know, when I first started making this video in its very early development, like when I was scripting it and everything, and obsessing over the tiniest little details, I initially thought that all of this motivation came from a place that I was trying to prove myself. Like, I was trying to show people that I can be a better YouTuber if I wanted to. But slowly, as that feeling diminished, I slowly started to realize the real inspiration of this video was actually a way to thank you. I'm actually really blessed to have one person watch my video, and seeing how I was absolutely, like, non-existent for a while, and I haven't been uploading or caring enough, I felt the need to make it up to you guys and do something special. It felt like an apology, a thank you letter, a 100k or 200k special subscriber video. Like, I want to tell you guys how much I appreciate the love and support you have showed me, and I really want to continue to make content. And as you can see on the screen, I want to give a special thank you to all the people who have been there for me and helped me in the hard times. I know some of you do it silently and support me, so if I forgot to put your name, I'm incredibly sorry. I don't mean to forget you, so please, please don't be upset, don't kill me. You can actually remind me in the comments down below and tell me when you subbed to me. And you know, there are only two things I'd ever ask people on YouTube, is that you would help me by liking this video. It is very simple, I know, but it helps me to grow this video. So please just like this video and leave a comment. And the second thing I would need from you is to follow my Twitter. If you haven't, I'm really trying to grow my community there and be closer to you guys, so please follow me on Twitter. But most importantly, like I always tell you on each video, that if you enjoyed this video, then please like, comment, and subscribe. And also, have a great day. Peace, guys.